Welcome to Whispers, everybody, on AM 1600 WKKX, the Valley's Watchdog. It is 7:07 p.m. Lola, we got some background music going on.
Oh, brother, not again. Oh, yeah, we do. Well, that's the song you wanted.
Got a little early.
It's 7:07 p.m. here in downtown Willings. 46 degrees. Number number here is 304-214-1600. If you're out of the area, give us a call. 1-866-514-1600. It's been a long
time. A long month.
Yeah.
I am ready for February to be over. I was talking to Jordan about this earlier. This has been a horrible, horrible month.
We've had to kick it to the curb. We moved our Tuesday debut back a week. There were some issues that we've had here. One of our hosts here at WKKX did pass away. This is our first show since then. So he was a very great man. His name was George Kellis. For those of you that are not in the Valley and listening, he will definitely be missed here in the Valley. We're going to go ahead and we're going to have a moment of silence for him, if you will. Just keep your thoughts and prayers towards him and his family.
If we had botched the moment of silence, George would have thought that was funny.
That's what I'm thinking.
Yeah. Here's to you, Georgie.
Yes. That was for you, George.
Next week will be our first Tuesday show.
We hope.
We'll be, unless we get bumped from something else.
Basketball's not over. That's the thing. You know, playoffs start in... We're not really in the clear until we hit March.
Yeah. Well, that is actually the first week of March.
Oh, my March 3rd. That's right.
That's what I said. We're kicking this month to the curb. February is the shortest month of the year, and it's felt like it was the longest month.
I don't think I've paid any bills this month.
Me and you both. I just found some surprises when I got home today. So it's...
If my cell doesn't answer, folks, it will after 5 o'clock tomorrow. It's been a bad month for me, you know, as far as trying to keep my head in the game and everything together. And, you know, so I think that may have been one of the things that kind of got...
So are the playoffs over now? I really don't know.
No, high school playoffs are just starting.
Oh, okay. I wasn't sure. Yeah. So they probably go into March.
Yes. Well, and then you have March Madness as far as, you know, college and NCAA.
Yeah. I think the way John has us set up, if we... if there is a basketball game on the night, we'll be just...
The next night?
Well, we'll be airing until tip-off.
Oh, that's... How I said. You know what? And I thought of that yesterday after, of course, I had already talked to you guys and we had already set it up for today. I thought, well, that was silly. We should have done that last night.
Yeah,
you know, just gone on at 6 and stayed on until 20 after 7. You know, but...
We got it next week. And
That works for me. That, you know...
We have a fun guest next week, too, Miss Lorraine Warren, who is a very well-known demonologist.
Do you know Amityville Horror?
How do you keep coming up?
Have you ever heard of the Amityville Horror?
Yeah.
She was one of the investigators. And her husband, Ed. Very famous.
And it's great because Nick, found a contact number.
On her website, yeah.
Just calls it up and says, excuse me, we'd like to book, you know, Lorraine Warren. She's like, well, this is Lorraine. And Nick goes,
because, you know, I read a lot of her stuff, you know, and I wasn't expecting her to answer. Then I called her again. Every time I call this woman, a rooster crows at her house.
Got to be a sign.
She's got pet roosters or something. I don't know.
That's great. My stepmom has pet roosters, too.
And then last time I talked to her.
And they were mean.
Yeah.
Mean.
Roosters are mean. They've chased me.
But last time she told Nick that she loved him. And Nick's like, I love you too, Mrs. Lorraine Warren.
Famous demonologist. What do you say to that, Lo?
Talk about classy. Classy. That's Mr. Nicholas
and this
Queen.
This is why I book all the guests.
Yeah.
They just love it.
Yeah, I've got to talk to him. Obviously, Tuesday, you know, Amanda wasn't on with us. But I want to talk to her about the guest we had on last week. I really want to hook those two up on the air. I think that could be really interesting.
We were actually talking to Dougie about that outside. And Dougie was like, wow, that would be an interesting show.
It would. His first name was Stefan, right?
Yeah. Stefan. It's weird. It is Stefan. I thought it was Stefan, too.
Indian.
Stefan. Well, you can't even call him Mister because I'm not sure how to pronounce his last name either. But
Stefan Watanabe.
Or no. Watanabe. That's a Japanese filmmaker.
Watanabe.
I was watching one of his movies yesterday. But, you know, she really is into spiritualism and crystals and all of that kind of stuff. And if he really wants to connect to why he first started having these images and everything about pyramids and where his spirit walk is taking him, who better than Amanda to try and see? The tricky part will be, and she has said this on many occasions on Tuesday, it's all done through energy. And with all of this equipment here, and I'm not trying to make it sound like a cop-out, but if she's not, you know, spot on with everything that she tells you, and then doing it through a phone line is even, you know, adds another level of difficulty. So we would have to have her in here, which would really be interesting because she is incredible to watch.
And we never get any guests in here with us.
Well, no, because they're all over the world, practically. We do not. I think they all think
freak us out.
After they've been on the show, with the exception of perhaps a couple of those pseudo-intellectuals that we've had, I think most of them have a really good time once, you know, we kind of loosen everything up and start just talking, you know? He said he had a good time.
That's because you were talking to him.
Yeah.
I mean, speaking of not having a good time, those that have visited our website have probably noticed that I haven't had a good time in the last week. Everything crashed.
Oh, no.
Lost most of the stuff. I've been talking to the guy that runs the server in Australia. He's still trying to put everything back together. His name's Pixie.
Our webmaster is in Australia?
I know, good figure.
He gives me free space. If I'm running out of space, I call him. He's like, I'll give you another gig or two. I can't even do an Australian accent.
I try my best. We humor him.
Also, to interrupt Nick so he doesn't make more of a, you know, whatever.
Too late.
If you have kind of registered a seat at the Pen with us and haven't got around to paying, and as you might have noticed, our website, you're unable to pay on anything right now because it's down, you can definitely either come to the studio and drop off your money, or you can get a hold of us on our email, whispers1600@gmail.com. And we can work out a way to get your payment in.
You have our voicemail number, too. Give that one out.
Voicemail number. This is an off-air voicemail to reach us through the week. It is 1-973-215-9178. And you can also call that. We can get in touch with you to make sure you get the payments in for the Pen trip. The sooner we get that, the better we
Because we have people wanting, at least we did on the forum, that wanted to join us, and then
because there are people that will use your slot, so to speak. Yes. If you can't go,
well, I already have a waiting list.
I'm just waiting to see
who's going to pay and who's not.
Right, well, we have our guest Alex on. I've got him
all right
connected. So
coming up with us is Mr. Alex Monty Conawati, a movie director from LA. Are you with us, Monty?
Yes, I am.
How are you doing, sir?
I'm fabulous. I'm at the center of my creativity. That's where I'm at. That's a good place to be. Well,
that sounds good. So tell us about your movie. What's been going on?
Well, the movie is called, I don't know if you've talked about it or what's been said, but the movie's called Return to Babylon, and it's a tribute to the silent movie era. It tells the tale of the true life scandals of the nation during the silent movie era, in particular William Desmond Taylor, who is murdered on February 1st, 1922, and his murder is still unsolved. We have the Clara Bow scandal. Clara Bow is played by Jennifer Tilly. We overview the Fatty Arbuckle scandal, the death of Virginia Rappe. So we have an overview of these horrifying events that really is fascinating because it's really taken during the time of the birth of cinema.
Mm-hmm.
And the film had a phenomenon in which there was called what is labeled spontaneous morphing, which has never been seen before. The actors, for some unknown reason, morph frame by frame into biblical imagery or what they would consider unnerving characters. So this phenomenon was something I became intrigued with, and literally as we're on the air right now, I am sitting with my web designer, Steven, and he is designing a website for this. It's actually already up, but it's being enhanced. ReturnToBabylon.com.
ReturnToBabylon.com.
Nice, right. Sir. Well, send me an email once you get that up, and I'll actually make sure I link to that.
Sure.
We can get that, get some hits your way.
Now, you were able to see the third cut, right?
Yes, I have a copy of that in my car.
Yeah. The next cut, which is a final cut, is going to be, we're going to up the ante on the psychological horror aspect of the film, and we're going to flesh out more of the characters. It's all a very exciting thing. What were your thoughts on the film?
I like it, and most people don't. I don't know if you said this already or not, but it is a silent film. You know, it is a modern-day silent picture.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's an interesting take because that's moved away so far from this culture.
So, yeah,
correct.
Which was, you know, some of the scenes we had to go back, you know, and just because it's not used to it. It's just one of those.
Oh, you guys, you got to learn to read subtitles. That's,
oh, I did.
You know?
I
love silent movies.
He has the cards. So
yeah.
It's even more. I mean, it was really interesting.
It's made just like the movies
the old
back
silent
in the day.
Movies. Yeah.
Got the bum, 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 da, 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 in the background, and
I can't
I
wait to see
again.
It. I no, please. I love silent movies. I love that whole era, and any opportunity I have, I you know turn
well,
to classic
we're,
movies.
We're waiting word any day now to see if we're accepted into the Beverly Hills Film Festival.
All right.
And the film festival takes place April 1st to April 4th. And I'm surprised it's already the 25th. They haven't sent out the acceptance letters. So
they'll get around to it.
You know, I mean, you know, you want time to promote the premiere, you know, especially when you've got, like, celebrity talent. They're always flying somewhere.
Yeah, you have a few big names in this, don't you? In this
I believe
film?
So.
Jordan.
Jordan Azar plays Gloria Swanson. She's notable for a number of things. Currently, she's on HBO's series Entourage. We have Jennifer playing Clara Bow. We have Maria Conchita Alonso playing Lupa Velez. Tippi Hedren, of course, from the infamous
The Birds.
Hitchcock, Ingenue, The Birds,
yes.
And Marnie. She plays a studio executive. So it's all, you know, very, very star-driven, really. Stars playing older stars.
Mm-hmm. Is this based on a book? Because that title, just before, long before the guys ever told me about this, the name is just ringing a bell somewhere.
Oh, you're referring to Hollywood Babylon. Babylon
Okay.
was actually a movie directed by film director D.W. Griffith.
Yeah.
And Babylon is associated, the name, with the silent movie era. So it's not really based on the book, but the book covers a lot. The film was based on a lot of newspaper accounts and many books. They were all true stories. But yes, there's definitely a verbal connection to Hollywood Babylon.
Now, what kind of reception have you received? I know you've taken the movie a couple of places. Where exactly are you taking the movie, and what kind of reception?
We've been test screening the film. The film is not final cut yet.
Okay.
We're working with a great editor, an award-winning editor. And we're shaping up, you know, like I said, the film is going to end up being told through the point of view of Rudy Valentino. It was Rudy Valentino that basically got all this started. The way the film started was my producer and I found a bag of film on Hollywood Boulevard just waiting to be exposed. There were 19 rolls of black and white film.
You're kidding.
Nope. And that's what started. Well, we shot one episode of the William Dyson Taylor that was called The Birth of Babylon. The Birth of Babylon won the grand prize at a Los Angeles Film Festival out of 3,000 entries, got the worldwide competition prize, and that sparked a huge interest. It was amazing. There was a $58,000 party thrown for an $800 movie that was shot in one day. So at the party, I met Maria Conchita Alonso, and it was a big star-studded event. And she said, well, when do we film the next one? And I said, what do you mean next? And 2 weeks later, we started Return of Babylon. I mean, here I was trying to keep up with the monstrosity of the movie, and one celebrity after another kept getting involved, and I had to start turning away others.
Oh, wow.
And I was just overwhelmed. I thought, what is going on? Turns out that on October 27th, I went to Salem, Massachusetts, and I stayed with a psychic named Jeffrey Justice. Lo and behold, we did a reading, and the spirit of Rudy Valentino came to him, which I was not surprised because Rudy had been making a number of appearances, and we filmed at Rudy's house, and the whole, you know, silent movie estates of Norma Talmadge and Antonio Moreno, which are like 10 to 15,000 a day, and here I am getting them for free, getting the actors. And I thought, something's going on. So he had been making appearances to me. Now I'm used to it, you know. Last night he appeared in the middle of the night, my roommate saw him. So he was orchestrating the whole thing, and it was great because through Jeffrey, we were able to have a long conversation. And he explained, he put the bag of film there, and he helped me do this great silent movie, of course, which he knows all about because he was friends with all the cast. The people that he knew, Gloria Swanson, of course. He did a movie with her called Beyond the Rush. And he was exceptionally, it was a life-changing experience. Because even though I had been seeing him since for years, he actually now had a conversation with me. And what we're going to do is, I'm hoping to get Jeffrey out to L.A. so we can you know.
Now, can you say that last part again? You kind of
lost it. We can videotape the next channeling.
Okay, wow.
Because it's fascinating. He even speaks in an Italian accent and everything.
Really?
Now you said that Rudy Valentino was appearing in your house?
He's a very good friend of mine. He not only appears in my house, but he makes his presence very felt. There's been a number of witnesses now.
Now, can you,
quite fascinating.
Can you tell us a few stories about this?
Well, my cousin Alex almost fainted.
I bet he did.
My roommate said he was here last night, wasn't he? And I said yes. He said yes. My roommate Jimmy. Also, incidentally, Rudy put me in touch with his nephew Giovanni Guglielmi. And on Friday, Giovanni's giving me Rudy's gold ruby ring.
Oh wow!
Because I portrayed him so well in the movie, I'm also getting his horse riding boots.
You know, yeah. First time you mentioned that, you portray in the movie. You are.
I play Rudy.
You
yeah,
play Rudy Valentino. Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Very good job, by the way.
I didn't want to play him, but there was such a strong resemblance that named Blaine Dunham, she said, you know, Monty, how could you get someone to play this? You've got to play it. You look just like Valentino. But it's so difficult to act and direct in your own movie, and I'm not really an actor. So I said, well, okay, I'll do it. And everyone said I did a good job. So there's definitely a... did you hear that siren?
Yeah. They're not coming for you, are they?
That was Rudy. He was playing a joke. Whenever there's a siren like that, he enhances something that he wants.
Oh, that crazy.
And he's a loving, very loving person. I mean, I'm indebted to him. I mean, once I have the ring on my finger, of course, that's going to be incredible. I'm going to videotape that.
No. What do you think that's going to do for you?
Well, I mean, to wear something that belonged to a silent film star who was so well respected. I mean, first of all, getting a ruby ring that size is just an amazing feeling, let alone now having it belong to someone who's such an incredible father figure, you know, is just I can't even describe the feeling.
How big exactly is the ring?
I haven't seen it, but Giovanni tells me it's huge.
So if we mug you in the street and...
That's what I'm worried about.
Yeah, I was going to say, I don't know if I'd wear it in the street.
Lola would love that.
I'm going to take a picture of that, and it's going to be all over the internet. I think that's press right there, if you think about it. I mean, here's this guy who plays Rudy Valentino, and then by chance, I meet Rudy Valentino's nephew in Palm Springs, and we both don't even live in Palm Springs, which is 2.5 hours away, or 1.5 hours from L.A. And we're both in Palm Springs at the same time, and we meet in a bar last May.
Now, how did you know it was happening?
Well, we just started small talk. And he said, what are you doing? And I said, oh, I'm playing this, you know, character named Rudy Valentino. And I had been in Palm Springs because I was meeting with an editor. And his eyes just lit up. He said, well, that's my grandfather was his brother.
Oh, wow.
And I said, what? I said, then you must be the grandson of Alberto. And because I knew the character so well and I read his biographies. I took Giovanni to the editing room and he saw the movie and he was just blown away. So we've kept in touch, and Rudy made it clear he was going to get a gift because he speaks to me telepathically. And lo and behold, Giovanni left. So I'm going to give you his ruby ring. It was going to be a surprise. I almost fainted. You know?
Yeah, to receive something from an icon, you know?
Well, and then to have it, he was going to give it to me on Valentine's Day. So it's kind of like so surreal, but Giovanni lives in a city called Newport Beach. And I live in Beverly Hills. And it's about an hour and a half away, you know, considering traffic. And we've been having in L.A. some heavy rains.
Right.
So some of the freeway was flooded. And so he wanted me to have the ring for Valentine's Day. And that time period, it was very rainy. So I told Giovanni, well, why don't we just meet? Because I'm in the editing room every day and all that. Why don't we'll just meet on Friday, this Friday.
Well, congratulations.
So it really is an amazing feeling.
Now,
you know,
with you're able to see, I guess, Rudy Valentino in your home and all that. Would you say that you're you know, now getting a psychic ability because of all this?
I'm definitely clairvoyant.
Now, how is this all coming about, you know, with the movie making and
I mean, he'll lead me to, you know, an editor, and he'll lead me to this and that, and I will say, you know, certain something about them, and they'd say, well, how did you know that? And they're quite alarmed. Of course, when they see the film, you know, they immediately want to get involved. You know, there's a certain magic to it.
And were you always into silent movies, or did this come about?
Ironic that you said that. One of my favorite films of all time is Singing in the Rain, which is about the silent movie era and the coming of sound.
Right.
The silent movies wouldn't become a fascination to me until much later in life. I graduated from USC Film School in 1991 when I was 21. And the silent movies were definitely not of interest to me during that period, even though we had to take, you know, a whole year of, you know, silent films, of course, in the curriculum. And I was just bored. Okay? And I, to be honest with you, when we started this film, and we shot at Rudy's house, I didn't even film any of the Rudy scenes at Rudy's house because I had no intention of doing the Rudy Valentino segment. I found the character quite boring. and then he said,
what does he think about that?
I was more interested. Well, he caught me off guard.
Yeah.
And now, of course, you know, I became fascinated with him. You know, when people start telling you you look like him, and then you start reflecting on, well, wait a minute, how did the bag of film get there? And how did I get the estates of the silent movies? Come on, it's definitely a renaissance. It's an awakening. And he had been appearing to me for quite a while. And, of course, you know, this was really playing tricks on my mind. And fortunately, it started now becoming witnessed by numerous people. So, there's a question of, am I seeing things? You know, am I going crazy? But if you look at all the scientific evidence, the movie, the filming at the house, you getting the ruby ring that belonged to him, you running into his grandnephew, Giovanni, in a bar.
And, yeah.
You know, you start thinking, well, wait a minute here. It makes perfect sense. Wouldn't you say so, Jordan?
Yeah, it's crazy stuff.
And let's put it this way. How did the film animate itself?
Yeah. Can you want to go into a little bit of that?
Well, what did you think of the ending where we show some of that? In the next version, it's going to be, we're discovering anomalies all the time.
Now, I'd like to see the next edit, too. You're going to have to send that to us.
Oh, well, I mean, hold your horses, Jordan. I'm not allowed to.
Jeez, Jordan.
My producer,
just demand.
is already alarmed that I sent you the film, and I'm not supposed to send it out to anyone.
Yeah, but
because in order to be qualified for Oscar nominations and the Academy, there's strict guidelines.
We never received anything.
Yeah, we don't know what you're talking about.
There you go, Jordan.
You're a crazy man.
The perfect
I have a while. I'm just going to sit and stare blankly at the screen, you know. So
she hasn't seen it either. She doesn't know we haven't.
If you want to hang tight just for a minute, we are going to take a break. It's our bottom of the hour break. And when we come back, we're going to get into more detail on the eerie things that are going on the set of your film.
Are you putting links to the movie?
Yep.
Okay, cool.
Okay. we linked up your where you were talking about the different things that happened on YouTube, and the pictures themselves are on our website, so people can take a look at them. So we'll be going through them.
We'll be right back here on AM 1600 WKKX. Yep.
Yeah.
Okay.
We'll be right back.
Do you want to dive into the bizarre world of the paranormal? Do ghosts, UFOs, or the supernatural amaze you to the point of wanting to learn more? Then you need BVRN, the Black Vault Radio Network. With more than 750 hours of on-demand talk radio, syndicated from more than 35 shows, the Black Vault Radio Network is your one-stop shop for the world of the unexplained. Check us out and tune in 24 hours a day, www.blackvaultradio.com. Again, that's www.blackvaultradio.com.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome aboard the Dog, offering nonstop local live talk radio service. Fasten your seatbelt and enjoy your trip. On the Valley's Watchdog, AM 1600 WKKX.
Welcome back to Whispers, everybody, on AM 1600 WKKX, the Valley's Watchdog. It is 7:36 p.m., 46 degrees here in downtown Wheeling. Our guest tonight is Mr. Alex Monikanawati, a film director from L.A., who has been visited by Mr. Rudolph Valentino, silent film star, and got some other paranormal happenings going on the set. How you doing, Mr. Kanawati?
Very well, thank you.
Now, I do have a question for you, Mark. I have to ask this because it's always been something that's fascinated me. When he appears in front, what does it look like? I mean, in movies you see different things.
You know,
it's kind of fuzzy or black and white. What does it look like?
One time how he appeared is you've got like a window in your house.
Uh-huh.
And the entire glass turns into his picture, like a black and white photograph.
Oh, wow.
Like you would pull up on the internet,
uh-huh.
And the entire glass becomes a photo, a still photo. Like if you've taken, you know, a picture of him and you've plastered it on the wall.
Yeah.
Another time he comes dressed as Valentino. Imagine you've got like a see-through wax figure, and inside there's a blazing light, and he'll be dressed in one of the same costumes.
Like the Sheik or something like that.
Like the Sheik or the Matador. And one time like he winked at me, and when he winked there was a huge twinkle in his eye.
That's just showing off.
Completely.
Yeah.
That was actually the first time he appeared to me. And I tried to videotape it with my roommate, Trish. And she was so startled. She got the camera on, and you could only get the audio. You could hear me going, hurry, hurry, it's Rudy. But she was so shaken. And when she actually took his photograph, it was just like this blurry light. Like, she was too afraid to get close to him.
Hmm.
So he was across the street from the house. This was in a city called Ojai, California, which is up north, about an hour north of L.A.
Uh-huh.
Like, it's a very arts community. I was living there at the time.
That's
a lot of times he appears in, like, a shadow on the wall, and you can see distinctly that it's a sheik or a matador. Because, you know, like a bullfighter, because he's one of his famous films, Blood and Sand, where he played a matador. A lot of times he's just this incredible light that's blinding. And I've seen that in the last few weeks.
Okay, Marty, we have a phone call, if you don't mind taking
it. Well, no, it just, it was Barb, and she just wanted me to ask, is there, do you ever get a smell when
a
he
smell?
Appears? Yeah.
There has been a smell on two occasions.
Of what?
There would be like a really foul smell, and I was with my cousin Alex, his name is Alex too, and that means get out of the area, the situation, like you need to move somewhere else.
Mark, how would you describe, I mean, you say a foul smell, like garbage, like sulfur?
Like sewage trash.
Okay, okay.
You know, and it means, I now know how to read the divine code, so that means, okay, we have to go somewhere else.
All right, so he's warning you about something that's about to happen or something.
Or
like
not warning you, he's telling you you need to leave this place and go somewhere else.
Oh, okay, like if you're at the wrong producer
someone,
or something.
Yeah. What happens is that there's an extreme number of coincidences. And, for example, my friend Lila, she lives in Toronto, and he speaks to me telepathically. And I'll tell her, you know, he says something about honey, and she's literally pouring honey into her tea.
Oh,
and
wow.
She's mixing the honey, and she's just terrible. She's like, how did you know? I just laugh. And I do these kind of things a lot, and some people get really frightened. Like, tell them something, and they're really baffled. How the hell did you just know? Or, like, for example, I told Lila a few days back, last Sunday, I said, look for emeralds. And she said, emeralds? I said, yes, word emerald. Well, later on that day, her father comes in with an emerald bracelet and gives it to her as a gift.
Wow.
And she just calls me up, and she's just like, oh, my God, my father surprised me with an emerald bracelet.
Now, did he ever tell you anything about us? I have to ask.
He did tell me to do the show.
Oh, good.
And he told me the reason why, because we were supposed to do this in December.
Uh-huh.
The reason why it didn't happen in December is because his clairvoyance with me and his communication with me wouldn't kick in till about December 23rd. When he became more pronounced. So that by the time we talk about it in February, I could tell you, sorry, in December, it would not have been this advanced.
Huh.
You see what I'm saying? Everything happens for a reason. And Rudy loves us.
He's a great guy. Without him, I would not have made this movie. There's no question about that. There's no question.
What?
You know, Jennifer Tilly, when we were shooting at the Nomatometry stage, she sensed the spirits. And she was very vocal about it. Of course, at the time, I thought maybe the woman needed her head examined.
Wow.
This was before, you know, it became really clear that we saw the footage in the editing room. And I took the footage to Brooks Institute of Photography in Santa Barbara, where they studied the film frame by frame. And Dean DiFilippo there was really alarmed. And since then, of course, I've had the film inspected by numerous religious groups. And, you know, I went to a demonology lecture at the Biola Christian University here in La Mirada, California. And they confirmed this is definitely a spiritual message of some kind trying to make its way through.
Let's talk about some of the images. We got, you know, some of the images from your, you sent us, and some of these are from MySpace. The one that always interested me is, looks like, and bear with me on this, looks like a guy that's kind of going through like this forest,
a garden, mm-hmm.
And all of a sudden,
yeah,
his nose just seems to,
yeah,
just elongate. I mean, what exactly is happening there? Where are you filming?
We were filming in a city called Pasadena.
Okay.
Ironically, that was the day before 9/11 that we shot on 9/10 of 2001. That was the eve of 9/11.
Huh.
And there are a lot of demonic images, or what people would label demonic, I call them anomalies, appeared that day. And, you know, we started laughing. That was one of the first images we found.
And then it's creepy.
Yeah. Oh, he's excited. The funny thing is, the actor who plays that character, okay, we're filming No More Humans. I mean, sure, they've got hair. And they've got, you know, well, he doesn't have hair. He's a shaved head. But, you know, we had the traditional hair and makeup, which was silent movie makeup. You know, a little bit dark, you know, lips and eyebrows. But nobody, you know, everyone was still human. They were Homo sapiens. This clearly is not human. No, I mean, who's got a Pinocchio nose like that with claws?
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, so that was one of the first things we found, and we started putting it all together. And definitely, You know, I think I'm going to have to give the CGI credit to Rudy Valentino.
Now, this was before you even, you know, knew about him, you know, personally.
I should have been more suspectful. I should have. But, I mean, of course, it wasn't until I took the film to Salem, Massachusetts to test screen it in Wichita on Halloween. And I arrived to Jeffrey's, you know, place on October 27th. And he was channeled. I mean, then we had a 30-minute conversation. And that was, you know, that becomes more explained because you're communicating like you and I are. When you see him appear in the window or the shadow, it's just a visual or the bright light. But when you're actually having a conversation, that's why I'm so eager to have Jeffrey come to L.A., but he's so incredibly booked because he's like one of Salem's most prominent psychics and always in demand. And we wanted to have the channeling in L.A. on Valentine's Day and videotape that. But Jeffrey's schedule was too booked, so we're going to see if we can do it in the next few weeks, because that would be that's so fascinating.
It is, very much.
Jordan, I mean, it's just fascinating, because Jeffrey's not there anymore. He's just an instrument, and you can hear Rudy talking to you. You know, it's just...
Now, I mean, does he talk to you now, because you say he gives you messages.
Telepathically. Telepathically, yes.
Now, of course, you don't need Jeffrey... I guess to do the channel at
this
point. No, but
I need Jeffrey as an instrument because that's he'll speak and it's more interesting for an audience.
Oh, of course.
Because
yeah.
to videotape myself talking to him, you know, they won't be able to hear him.
You're like, well, what is he doing? Yeah. Talking to yourself. Exactly. It would have asked questions.
Now, you also went to Sylvia Brown about this,
her.
Too. How did she feel
she
about
it? She actually called me. Oh, she said there's definitely something going on without question. In her belief, you know, that was definitely the Christ himself that appears in the film, because we have a lot of Christ-like images. She was actually going to get me on the Montel Williams show, but they had a ticket out of syndication just 2 weeks later. I talked to her once in a while, and I'm going to finish the movie. Our deadline is April 1st, and I spoke to her last week. I will, then we'll gear up for a publicity campaign, you know.
Yeah.
Everything has to come in order. I mean, we're working on the webpage now. And we're building up.
How long do you think you have the webpage done?
Well, it's up right now, returnofbabylon.com, but my web designer's in the next room. And, you know, it's a work in progress, so you keep adding new photos. And,
okay.
You know.
A lot of those photos, then, are on the website, that where you've just, you know, cut it out of the film.
Right.
Right? Okay.
When did you start noticing stuff? I mean, how did you start noticing with just all... Because a lot of this stuff, like you said, you have to go through frame by frame. And when we were watching the movie...
I was with Dean from Brooks Institute of Photography, and everyone was interested in the film because the black and white was so sumptuous. So Dean was actually studying the film. And that's his job, you know, as a photography teacher. And, you know, they get really into it. But the shadows and the key lights and filler. And he was like the third or fourth person to say, did you do any special effects? And I thought... No, why does everyone keep asking me that? Then he paused the film on the guy with the nose. Okay?
Yeah.
And he said, how do you explain that? And I just started laughing. I said, I have no idea. And so then for 3 solid days, we just started going through the film frame by frame. And I was completely caught. This was in January of 2004.
Oh, wow.
So it's been a long process.
And some of the other images, the next one that we have on our website looks like a woman... kind of like her face has been either elongated or kind of like shifted a little bit.
It looks like a 4 or 5 hour makeup job.
Yeah, and it's just it's a really...
And that's every frame. Imagine there's 24 to 30 frames per second.
Okay, we got another call from, or another question from a caller.
Yeah, we're back to the smells that you may smell when he comes in. She wanted to know if you've ever smelled tobacco or roses.
Definitely the roses.
Okay. I don't know why. She didn't. Her phone was dying.
Really interesting because it's really interesting. She says that he told me that I would, during the course of the show, somebody would mention roses. Huh. He hates fake flowers that people leave at the crypt here at the Hollywood Forever Cemetery.
Yeah.
So he has me remove the fake flowers and I replace them with real ones.
Oh, well, that can get expensive.
Well, yeah, but it's more tasteful.
Yeah.
No, because it's only $1.95 for one rose. So I, you know, just put one rose. I mean, special events, I'll do more than one.
Yeah, yeah.
But that was one of his instructions during the channeling on October 27th.
Yeah, he died quite young, too, didn't he? He died
31 years old.
Yeah, 31.
Yeah. He died in 1926.
Yeah, from a ulcer, I think, wasn't it? An ulcer.
Pardon?
It was from an ulcer.
Yes.
Yeah.
Blood poisoning, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, way too young. Although, I don't know if he would have made it in talkies, you know, with such a thick accent.
He had a very thick accent. I think he still does. And it's really hard to say. Because Greta Garbo had a very thick accent, and she made it.
Yeah, that's true.
So, it's really hard to say.
Yeah, Marlena Dietrich, too.
Marlena wasn't a silent film star.
Whatever. She never did any silent film?
She was an extra in one silent film.
Oh, I thought she
had started. But Greta was actually a star.
Yeah.
So Marlena doesn't count.
Oh, okay.
But she still nevertheless made it, but she had a German accent.
Yeah.
But Greta was Swedish. So it's really hard to say if Rudy would have crossed over. It's interesting because talkies wouldn't come in until later, in 1927.
And what year did he die now?
He died in 1926, August 1926.
Oh, okay, yeah. Okay. Yeah. So,
well, how does he feel about his death?
He said there was some foul play.
Oh, really?
And unfortunately, you know, a lot of the people that knew that, it was a heavy, heavy, heavy kept secret. They're all dead now, of course.
Mm-hmm.
So, there was some...
Oops, we just lost you. Oh, we're losing you again.
And I have to ask, we have to call him back. If it was foul play, I mean, who...
Hey,
there you are.
More about that.
We thought we lost you there, so we...
Well, it was just breaking up, that's all.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Monty.
I have to talk to him more about that. My communication with him right now is strictly getting the movie and getting it done and things like that.
I would be interested in, because, I mean, during that time period, you mentioned Fatty Arbuckle, you mentioned, I mean, all these different scandals were going on, I would say more so, well, maybe more so than today, I mean, at least colorful kind of scandals, so it would have been interesting.
Monty, we got another phone call, this is Josh.
Go ahead, Josh.
Hey, how you doing? Good show, it's very interesting. I have a question for Monty. Do you think that Rudolph Valentino has made himself appear to you because of your affinity for him? Maybe he was kind of like latched on to you because of...
The channeling with Jeffrey is that we knew each other during the silent movie era. We've been on this side and side together.
Mm-hmm.
And it caught me off guard. Like I said, I was going to even do the Rudy Valentino segment.
Uh-huh.
So... he was one of the first houses that we got, which came out of the blue, and I didn't even know about the house, Falcon's Lair, it's called. We filmed a Ruben sequence, a Fatty Arbuckle sequence. By the time I had interest in him, we had moved to the Norma Talmadge estate. So I was kind of caught off guard. I mean, he definitely picked me, you know, and he made it clear that we had known each other.
That's interesting. I'm looking at your pictures, though. I don't want to... use up all the time, but I'm looking at your pictures. You gotta admit they are a little disturbing. I mean, they're not pictures of angels or anything. Does it occur to you that maybe
I call them anomalies?
Anomalies, have you thought that maybe this has brought something not so good into your world, your set, your movie?
Tom made it really clear to me that there's nothing evil, negative about this at all. I mean, I look at it as art. I don't see it as any more negative or evil in Frankenstein, Dracula, or the Mummy movie in the 30s. You know, to me, I wanted to make a psychological thriller, and think of the Wicked Witch and the Flying Monkeys in Wizard of Oz.
Right,
they're scary.
Well, part of, you know, there's gargoyles in many churches, and so all these things are always part. You've got to have a villain. You know?
Yeah.
Quite frankly, I found them much more interesting than the Christ-like images. The Christ-like images, okay, they're interesting, but anybody could look like that, you know? But...
I know, you should see Lola with a beard.
There you go.
Oh. Thanks.
Like the bearded lady at the circus.
Yeah, yeah, I'll get them. They forget I've got the button.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Sorry, Lola.
Josh.
Anyway, how much more time do we have? Because I have a meeting that I have to get to.
We're actually out of time. Yeah.
Hey, Josh, thank you very much for your call.
Thanks, Josh.
Take care.
Have a good one. Mr. Conwadi, that is actually all of our time.
Okay.
So we can wrap it up.
Great. Sorry, I didn't mean to rush you.
Oh, that's okay.
In an hour. It was a pleasure. Let's keep in touch, and then I'll keep you posted.
Definitely. Yeah. The website is returntobabylon.com, correct?
Mm-hmm. And my MySpace is myspace.com, Monty Valentino.
And we have that one linked up on our website.
So you can go to whispersradio.com, and you'll be able to see the pictures we were talking about.
Video.
Alex Monty Conawati's MySpace, and we will put a returntobabylon.com link on there as well.
Thank you very much.
Monty, have a good one, and good luck with the film.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
I see what Josh is at, and that's a very good question I hadn't thought about. And he even said he went to a demonologist, so...
I'm not convinced on any of this game. I'm sorry.
You're not? It's interesting, and that's what Barb
called back to say that she's not buying this.
Not buying it.
I mean, what now? You know, maybe is, maybe isn't.
Uh-huh.
If you had been murdered, would you not? And you had the ability to actually communicate instead of in symbols and signs, like so much of spirit does, that you actually can speak to somebody. Mm-hmm. Would you not say, "Hey, so and so," you know, poisoned me,
and there's
something.
And there's some famous cases of that, actually. The Greenbrier ghost.
Yeah, the Greenbrier ghost here in West Virginia.
Yeah, had appeared to her mother saying that her husband had killed her, and it was one of the few court cases where, you know, I think that was brought up.
The ghost was the witness, and he was actually
speaking through the mother.
This is a great publicity gimmick for him, and then the stuff about, you know, that they... lived to in the past, they had a past life together, I'm sorry, but you know, he's supposed to be a clairvoyant, and I told you guys on the break, when I called him, he had forgotten that he had to do this. Now, Rudy, if you are his social secretary, you drop the ball.
Well, he called me 2 hours ago to say, hey, what time are you calling tonight?
He had forgotten. He goes, who? I said, you know, the radio show, Whispers. Oh, this is the radio show? Yeah. Oh, I forgot.
That would have been a long show of us giving the time every few minutes.
So, it's 7:02.
May not have been too bad.
We had to win a break on that one.
Well, I just, you know, he just, I don't, something doesn't necessarily ring true with this. And I, you know, I am the first one to give the benefit of the doubt on this kind of stuff. And I just, I don't know. Maybe if it were outside of Hollywood, outside of, you know, him making a movie.
Yeah.
Well, no, I will give, the people get wrapped up when they start working on movies like this. They get wrapped up in the subject matter.
Well, then he needs a good shrink. And believe me, there's plenty out there.
Dr. Bailey, if you're listening.
Yeah, we got a new client for you.
Paging Dr. Bailey.
There's a difference between getting wrapped up in you know, the movie and in the making of it, and even particularly in your character, and taking it to this extreme.
Sure.
You know, in trying to publicize the fact that, you know, Rudolph Valentino is speaking to me clairvoyantly and telling me how to make this movie. And, you know,
the images that he shows us, they're interesting. There's some, you know, I wish we had more time to go in depth into each one of them, because there's some interesting questions that I had, and Jordan and I have both been talking about it. You know, could it be kind of a matrixing thing?
Nick and I, you know, we've done paranormal investigating for so long, and part of it is analyzing pictures. And analyzing film. And when you go through it, like, frame by frame, you know, things happen in between frames that you can kind of...
Because film's not going to capture anything just like life. I mean, film's going to be... It's only 32 frames per second, and stuff's going to happen.
You get a video of a girl shaking her head. At one point in time, the hair is going to go over her face and look, she has a beard. That's...
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. When you take, yeah, if you stop it.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the whole point with, and you got to, you know, you can do anything anymore.
Oh,
computer generated.
Yeah.
You know, I want to watch what you guys have. And, but, you know, I don't know. Maybe, like I said, if it were outside of the movie industry and he wasn't trying to sell a movie, because when you Google it, there's already a whole, there's a whole bunch
you
of.
Mute yourself.
Yeah. web pages and Wikipedia and everything else is
yeah.
It, up there.
Jordan's
so.
Just interested in the fact it has Jennifer Tilly.
There's a lot of really great actors and actresses in this movie.
You love Jennifer Tilly.
I'm a Jennifer Tilly fan. I can't
help
it.
That's okay. Well, seeing Tippi Hedren, she's always kind of creeped me out because of the characters that she played, like the birds. I got this real thing about birds.
I need to watch the birds. It's one of the few Alfred Hitchcock movies I have not watched.
No, see, and I didn't. The birds scared me so.
Every time we go over the bridge over here, it looks like the birds.
Going into Bridgeport, those trees look like they're alive. There are so many blackbirds in them. And I've just got this thing about birds, like walking through. You know, they show that piazza in Italy where all the pigeons are.
Yeah.
Not this girl. I'd be throwing rocks to make a move before I can't. And it's all from seeing.
Don't throw rocks at the birds.
They're going to come
after you.
Well, that's what I'm afraid of. I saw that movie at a very impressionable age, and I'd never really cared for Marnie, but I just didn't like Marnie. But Tippi Hedren is a great actress. I mean, there's no two ways about it. But well, we are done, young men.
All right, who we got next week, there, Nikki?
Next week we have Lorraine Warren.
It is going to be quite the show, ladies and gentlemen. You better not miss that one.
And hopefully on Tuesday at 6 o'clock, 6 to 8. At the very least, we'll be here 6 to 7. I think we've agreed. So,
okay. Hey, remember, come with your stories prepared, because if it's the two-hour show, that first hour is you guys, your stories, your call-ins, your ideas, your thoughts. It's going to be an hour dedicated to you guys each week. So,
thanks to Josh for calling in today. So,
you'll have to
make sure you call back next week.
Okay. Until next week, everybody, don't be afraid, only believe.